Now, Evelyn Glennie in Rio on stage.
I think just experiencing the vastness of everything in Brazil. I mean, the carnival, the color, the volume of sound, the people and so on, the spectators, everything is just so overwhelmingly huge. And I want to put this energy into the pieces I play.
Evelyn Glennie's rise to being one of the world's few classical solo percussionists was hard won in a number of ways. To have reached this point in her early 20s shows she obviously has great ability, but to do so in the face of profound deafness takes determination and a highly developed extra sense as well. She didn't even have the advantage of a musical background in her childhood home in the countryside of Aberdeenshire.
I grew up on a fairly average-sized farm for our particular area, so really, my childhood was spent very much outdoors. My parents are farming people through and through, and so there wasn't really any emphasis on anything. That is, there wasn't emphasis on music, nothing at all, really. And it wasn't until, oh, I don't know, I was about maybe 10 or 11 that we even got a record player.
She led a healthy outdoor life, her hearing perfectly normal for the first few years, until at primary school, things gradually began to go wrong.
When I was very young, around about 6, 7 years old, I continually had very sore ears, especially if I went outdoors and if it was particularly windy or something. But it wasn't really until the headmistress at Kirinori School who said, well, Evelyn's work is schoolwork is deteriorating just a little bit. And so she asked my parents to see a doctor and so on, just to check my hearing. So he noticed just a slight deterioration, but nothing to worry about at all, until eventually, as I grew older, I discovered that I wasn't latching on to things at all, and I found I really was concentrating on people a lot more. So in order to hear them, I really had to look at them. And but I just thought, well, I was losing my hearing. I didn't think I was actually going deaf.
The slide was so gradual that she managed to hide her increasing problem even from her family and friends. But by the time she was 12, she'd become profoundly deaf. It was then that she took a decisive musical step.
I started percussion when I was 12 years old, when I started secondary school. And I really don't know why percussion. I can never really answer that. I think I was very interested in the physical aspect of playing, and which I couldn't find really when I played the clarinet or even the piano so much. And I wanted to move more, I wanted to express myself more rather than just through sound. But one of the most important instruments that I started off with was the side drum or snare drum, and I loved this instrument a lot. It was very neat, small. I could have it next to my body. I liked it a lot.
The snare drum has remained a favorite instrument, and she still uses it in solo recitals. This piece is based on a standard set of percussion rudiments. As a deaf teenager, she now faced the challenge of somehow finding a way to sense the music, however impossible it seemed at first. She was lucky to have a teacher who was perceptive and persistent.
My percussion teacher used to take two hand-tuned timpani, and he would tune them to two different notes, a fairly wide interval apart. And he would ask me, while my back was turned, he would ask me, well, which drum is producing the higher note or the lower note? And so I would have to tell him, and he would say, well, look, try not to listen to the note through your ears. Try somehow to sense it some other way. He didn't know how, I didn't know how. And so eventually I said, oh, well, I think that drum has got the higher note. And so he said, well, how do you know? So I thought, well, I don't know, there's a feeling. I seem to feel it, you know, from maybe the waist downwards or something, whereas the other drum I felt from up here downwards. And so eventually he got me to place my hands on the wall outside the room, and he would play the two drums, and he would, by this time, he would make the interval very small indeed, maybe just a second apart, and he would say, okay, which is the higher drum? And I would say, well, the higher drum I felt maybe from here downwards, and the other drum, the lower drum, maybe down to there. There was just such a slight difference. And so this was the introduction, I think, to discovering, well, certain notes I can feel in various parts of my body. The only time I really had to be very determined was near the end of my school days, when you meet up with career people and who say, well, what do you have in mind after school? And I said, well, I think, you know, I would like to try music. And she said, no, be reasonable. You can't do music if you can't hear. And I said, listen, you're not me. I know what I'm capable of.
By the time she was 16, she'd conquered even the marimba, one of the most subtle instruments of tuned percussion. She won a scholarship to the Royal Academy of Music, who called her back for a second audition because they couldn't believe she was deaf. She moved alone to London, not worried about the problem of getting by in a place so different from her farm at home, but single-minded in her determination to succeed at her music.
I think when I first arrived in London, I had carved out in my mind exactly what I wanted to do and exactly how I wanted to use my 3 years in London studying. And I was here just to do that. But more than anything, I just wanted to play. I mean, I really wanted to play my heart out. And it was so difficult to really express myself when I was in an orchestra, because there was someone else dictating the tempo, how loud or soft, basically, and so on.
It was also demanding to have to be aware of the sound the whole orchestra was making, and to keep her own instruments in tune with it. Probably the hardest drums of all to tune, particularly in concerts, are the timpani.
The timpani are all different sizes, and I find the smaller the drum, the harder it is to tune. There's less feedback coming through my body. But basically, my foot always stays on the pedals, so that, first of all, I release the pedal completely so that we get a very baggy type sound, very low. The sound is working its way up my foot there, and so that the highest note would just be on my big toe probably, but also the response of my stick from the head is really shooting up more, so when the head is slack, it's dead, it lies in the skin. So the response is much clearer. So let me tune this. The vibrations I'm feeling from these drums, I'm actually getting in the same part of my foot, so I know that I'm either on the same note or else very, very close. This drum here is exactly a fifth apart, interval-wise, from this drum. And when I sing into this note, I mean into this drum, I'm actually singing the note that this drum is tuned to into this one, which is a fifth lower. And so the feedback comes right back into my face, and you can actually hear the harmonics. And that means that it's exactly a fifth. However, if this is slightly sharp, and I still sing this note, there's nothing, there's no feedback at all. So I'll pop it down.
Stage will continue in a moment on A&E.
New on video from Warner Brothers Family Entertainment, the story of a young girl who discovers a magical world of mystery and enchantment.
Look!
The Secret Garden, now at a special low price.
Are you making this magic?
You are.
Enjoy this timeless Warner Brothers classic and receive a free silver-plated locket packed with each specially marked video cassette. Plus, get $5 back in mail-in rebates from St. Ives Swiss Formula Botanical Hair and Skin Care Products. Come to the place where miracles grow, The Secret Garden, for sale wherever videos are sold.
Right now, you can make a decision that can save your company hundreds of hours and thousands of dollars.
More than a million small businesses already have. It's the corporate card from American Express. It says you do things professionally right from the start. Use it for all your business expenses, like your company's gas and auto repairs. We'll report them by category so they're easy to track. And we'll even provide records of charges to make tax time easier.
And it's so easy to apply. Call 1-800-SUCCESS. Just answer some quick questions and they'll start processing your application immediately.
As your company grows, every card member can share benefits like accident disability insurance, savings on hotels and car leasing. So keep on doing what you do best, and let the corporate card do the rest.
Call right now. Just say, you want the corporate card.
That's 1-800-SUCCESS, the corporate card to your success.
The steel wreck is about the plumber.
Today's office doesn't always come with four walls. So no matter where your employees do business, AT&T has a way to help them and to give you more control. Call for the AT&T corporate calling card.
Hi.
We can customize a plan by letting you choose from more than 70 different features. If you're responsible for controlling expenses, we can customize your bill by location, individual, or account code. If you're concerned about card security, we offer customized fraud protection for your company and employees. We also offer discounts as high as 40%, a variety of competitive savings plans, and easy worldwide access.
We got the job!
Call AT&T now and decide how many or how few features you need. The AT&T Corporate Calling Card.
I don't know, call it a hunch.
Find out how customized a calling card can be.
Cut.
Yeah, Bob. The Russians look great, but these rewrites are killing us.
It was the day of the Wild West, the time of discovery, the era of the railroad. Relive the romance of life in a forgotten age. Experience travel like you've never done before. And go inside the milestone that forever changed our lives. The intrigue and the power that were the beginnings of a modern world. This is Locomotion. Beginning Sunday, March 6th, only on A&E. It's time well spent.
A&E returns to the Brazilian beat of percussionist Evelyn Glennie.
I just spend a long time, maybe a week to 2 weeks, just simply looking at the music, working out the sticking, the phrasing, I'll write it all in. And then, by the time I pop it on a music stand, on the instrument, I've memorized what it looks like on the page, on manuscript. And that's actually very important, because at least I know what's across the page. And I can afford to look down on my instrument to see whether I'm playing right or wrong notes. And then perhaps I may listen to a record or a cassette. And I just simply take the speakers off a record player and I place it in between my knees. And I can get really two basic things, the basic rhythm or tempo, and also the general dynamics and general interpretation. But I wouldn't really be able to detect whether it's a good performance or a very good performance.
If she has a cassette to listen to, she puts it in a clattery old player that vibrates as much as possible. She feels the sound through her body so well and translates it so accurately into music that she says that she now has no desire ever to get her hearing back. She's become sanguine about being a deaf percussionist. Her problems seem less to do with her hearing than with finding pieces to play. The classical tradition hardly ever features solo percussion.
The repertoire for percussion was really nil. I mean, I could hardly come across any solo pieces at all. And so this meant that I had to arrange a lot of music. So now I arrange all sorts. I arrange piano music, flute music, violin music, anything that I think may work. So, I mean, for example, I may arrange a Chopin etude for marimba and piano accompaniment. I use a lot of his pieces. Anything at all I think is suitable, I'll play.
While she arranges some pieces and commissions others, the most fertile source of new work is in other musical traditions. Percussion is the most universal of instruments, but the marimba is particularly admired in Japan, and Glennie went there to study with Keiko Abe, one of the country's leading marimba players.
We had, first of all, two marimbas facing each other in a tiny, tiny room, and she would say to me, oh, let's pick the first bar or the first phrase of this piece that was actually written down. And she would say, have a look at it. So I'd have a look at it, and she would shut the book and say, okay, let's play that phrase and improvise on it, and we would do it together. So that made me pour things out that I didn't realize I had inside me. And also, her own pieces that she composes are really improvisations that she tries to write down. One of the pieces, for example, was that she was suffering from a social disappointment, so she went to her marimba and composed a very simple Japanese theme that had the intervals, the fourths and fifths and so on, and then she left the performer to improvise on this theme.
Thank you.
the sounds, you know, of Japan, the intervals and so on. But then during the middle of the piece, I bring the harmonies to Western harmonies, so that the piece, first of all, is called Michi, which means path. And so I just see this path going right round the world. So I encompass all the harmonies from various places, going back to Japan again.
But if she took Japan in her stride, she would find Rio de Janeiro an altogether different experience.
We'll have more music from percussionist Evelyn Glennie on A&E.
When you think it's perfect,
put your arms around me.
I love you. Think again. Ed Harris.
I just want to know the truth.
Madeline Stowe.
You said you'd protect me. Do it now.
China Moon, rated R. Starts Friday, March 4th.
So you're really giving all this up?
Who knows what's right? All I know is how I feel. And I'm feeling I missed enough of Jenny's life already. I don't want to miss any more.
You guys gonna be okay on one salary?
Actually, our broker of Payne Webber made it a little easier. When she heard I was pregnant, she got us to start investing long term to give us some more options down the road.
How'd she know you were thinking about all this back then?
I'm not sure I was. Until she asked.
Brilliant stars. Dazzling performances, classic films from Hollywood, and contemporary drama from the world's great directors. The movies on A&E. Brought to you by 100% Colombian coffee, the richest coffee in the world.
We were 3 days out of Dakar.
On the Queen Elizabeth II.
I was right in the middle of an apricot flambé.
Captain, I'm afraid we've just run out of Colombian coffee.
Run out, Mr. Harwood?
Full about, Mr. Roberts. Engine room, full speed.
So, we turned back. Under the circumstances, it was the only civilized thing we could do.
100% Colombian coffee, the richest coffee in the world.
Celebrating 10 years of unique, original, timely television. A&E, it's time well spent.
She has intrigued and dazzled us for nearly half a century. Read all about Elizabeth Taylor in the February issue of the A&E Monthly. Also celebrate 10 years of A&E programming with a memorable look back and an exciting look forward. To order the A&E Monthly for only $18 a year, $23 Canadian, call 1-800-238-2800. Call now and receive a free CD of Red Hot Jazz performed by Canadian Brass.
On the next Sherlock Holmes Mysteries.
A horse is a most gregarious creature.
A thoroughbred is missing, and his trainer's found dead.
The case promises to be absolutely unique.
Then on Lovejoy Mysteries, it's the art scam of the century.
How would you like to be paid? Lavishly.
But diamonds, beautiful women, and Gustav Klimt don't add up to a pretty picture.
Time to go.
Both on the A&E Monday Night Mysteries. Monday on A&E.
A&E returns to the Brazilian beat of percussionist Evelyn Glennie.
The samba is unique to this country and is as much a cultural expression as a form of music. We were giving Glennie just a week before she'd take part in the famous carnival parade. First stop was the music shop to choose some of the instruments used in the samba, guided by Alan Heyman of the London School of Samba, who was also over for the carnival.
Oh, that's tuned up.
I wanted to learn the various aspects of their percussion playing, to find out about their instruments, which are mainly fairly small instruments, and you can learn a few tricks, but the only way you can really express yourself is by actually joining in. You can't actually practice maybe 6 hours in your bedroom or something like that. So it's just really another aspect of playing that I want to explore, but I don't want it to be a once-in-a-lifetime experience. It really has to be an ongoing process.
Drums are among the most traditional elements of any samba group, but Glennie would have to carry her instrument for at least 2 hours in the heat of the parade procession. She therefore looked at the lighter tambourines.
That sort of technique, some to appeal to. Try with this one. This is a smaller one. It's easier to carry. Okay.
Glennie came away with a number of instruments unique to Brazil to take back home, but the one she was to use in the parade was the tamborim, which is played with a kind of splayed stick, while the other hand strikes the skin from inside. She practiced with a member of the samba school she would soon join.
I read certain rhythms in various Latin percussion books, and I thought this looks too easy, because it was very easily notated and read and so on. I thought something is very wrong here, because it can't be as easy as this. And so I immediately thought, well, it must be the feel, the way that they actually play it from the heart, and that's something that just can't be taught.
Samba is rooted far back in Brazilian tradition, originating with the Angolan slaves brought over by the Portuguese colonists in the 16th century. The African rhythms were used in slave dances as a form of martial art and in circle dances to keep alive their native religions and their sense of community. Above all, their drums beat out sensual fertility dances, sending the participants into an erotic trance. In the northeast of Brazil, where the slaves first landed, this old samba remains strong, and samba groups still go through a religious ritual before they rehearse together. This is candomblé, a hybrid of African spirit worship and Jesuit Catholicism, and it's well established throughout Brazil. The rhythms invoke their gods, who often have dual African and Christian identities. The Virgin Mary has become associated with the Amancha, goddess of the sea, whom the believers of Rio appease and pray to on the beaches each new year. She's a playful deity who accepts expensive gifts from her impoverished people who hope to be granted good fortune. The cult is as dominant here as Christianity, and its rhythms are fundamental to samba. On one level, an expression of cultural identity, on another, merely a complex syncopation. The goddess of the sea presides in Rio, and its port and miles of coastline have given rise to a sprawling and populous city, but a city divided. It houses 8 million poor in its hills and central areas, while an extremely wealthy few reside in a thin strip along its south coast in Copacabana and Ipanema, the most glamorous addresses on the whole continent. This is where the spectators of the carnival parade will come from, paying £700 a seat from million-dollar apartments and luxury hotels along the promenade. And they have their samba too, shorn of religion or the slave dance, but insistent and sensual all the same. Carnival was originally solely the preserve of the rich and was a high society parade along strongly European lines with floats, costumes and music. The modern style of procession began in 1932 and was still a fashionable festival, but the rhythms were now those of the samba, provided by large percussion bands known as bateria, who played a single tune over and over again. These bateria came from the favelas, the shanty towns that sprung up on the hillsides of the town in sight of the beaches. In those days, a heavy rainstorm would be enough to send them crashing headlong down the slopes. Now they're brick-built and have the mod cons the residents want, electricity and television, but no sanitation. These are the living conditions of most who work in the hotels and shops that serve the tourist industry. And it's from places like these that community groups known as samba schools first grew up. This culture has gradually taken the carnival over from the rich, and the parade is now entirely theirs, from the floats and costumes to the reverberating rhythms. The samba is in their blood. All year round, small groups will form and play in bars and on street corners, carnival or no carnival.
I don't think I'll ever crack playing samba music because I think it's something that you need to do day in, day out. You need to be showered by samba music. The people in Rio it's just a way of life there. They're more rhythm players than percussionists. You know, they can make music out of a box of matches. Way to release tension, I think, because you're not glued to music or something like that. There's no great deal of thought. It all comes from here. Nothing is from the head. Nothing's academic or thoughtful, really. And so what if you do a mistake? You know, no one really would notice that much. There's just great energy here, and I feel great. And it really makes me want to play my other music in a new light, much, much better, I think. I feel ready to start it with new vigour.
With three nights to go before the carnival parade, Glennie crosses Rio to rehearse with the samba school she is to join, the Unidos do Cabuçu. There are over 20 such schools, all based in specific areas of the town. Cabuçu is from a poor area on one of Rio's northern hills. They rehearse in a vast open-air shed, more than 2,000 dancers and over 100 percussionists.
It was very interesting when I first went to the rehearsal. I've only had one rehearsal at the samba school, and it was rather overpowering in that even I have to say the volume was so incredible that, I mean, it was deafening. It really was. It was just like bullets. You almost felt yourself jutting back with the volume, in particular with the surdo, which is the large sort of bass drum that's really the backbone of the batteria.
The members of the samba school were not told who Glennie was, nor that she was profoundly deaf. Each viewed the other with curiosity.
I was thrust into a role of other tambourine players, and there were two rows of us, in fact. And I had a look around, and they were all males, fairly hard, butch-looking males. And when they saw I was female, they looked round as well. And also, when they discovered I was a Westerner, what I did was simply stare at them back, saying, well, I'm going to show you. I've been used to. Basically, I've got to become a Brazilian here and now, you know, in order to fit in. The funny thing was, though, that I almost didn't hear the sound by the end. It was just the feel that came through because it was so loud. And I could actually only hear my next door neighbor, who was also playing the tambourine. I couldn't hear myself, I couldn't hear anything else. It was just a sensation, a vibration that was just so, so incredible. I've never experienced that before.
Stage will continue in a moment on A&E.
Excuse me, could you tell me how to get to Bakersville?
Sure. Take 23 north to M33 west to I-14 south, and you're there.
Thanks.
You bet.
Excuse me, can you tell me how to get to Bakersville?
Head right over those mountains.
Thanks.
Unlike big juice companies, we have a different idea about corporate ladders, mergers, even stockholders' meetings.
Morning, Ed. Hi, Bob.
Florida's natural brand is a not-from-concentrate orange juice made by a co-op of Florida growers whose only business is making juices. They own the land, they own the trees, they own the company. It makes for a difference you can taste. Florida's natural brand, premium orange juice.
Hi, I'm Jim Palmer. There's still time to refinance your home at the Money Store, even if you have less than perfect credit. Over the last year, thousands of homeowners across America have refinanced their mortgages with the Money Store. You can apply by phone anytime at the Money Store, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and there's never an application fee. So to refinance your mortgage, even if your credit is less than perfect, call the Money Store at 1-800-LOAN-YES. The Money Store, where America goes for money.
I sent you out to bring in a thief. Instead, you gave him a horse to get away.
The only thing stronger than a family's bond...
You ain't gonna hang alone.
...was the law.
It's the old story of good and evil.
The only things that could come between brothers...
Where's the payroll?
...was a six-gun and 10,000 in cash.
Maybe you better move along.
I'm a better gun than you. Or would you like to try?
Jimmy Stewart, Audie Murphy.
You'll get that money even if you have to kill your own brother.
Night Passage, Sunday on A&E.
In business, a lot can happen. If you want to keep up every week, you have a choice. Not Forbes, not Fortune. You can read Business Week, or you can read a week of the Wall Street Journal. Either way, you'll find out all you need to know. The question is, how much time are you willing to spend in the process? Business Week is designed for busy people. One look at the cover, and you'll know exactly where to turn inside. A quick scan of the contents page and you'll have all the events of the week that interest you.
Now is the time to subscribe to Business Week, because right now you could get 28 issues of Business Week for the low rate of $30.50, a savings of more than 60% off the cover price. And with your paid subscription, we'll send you this compact cordless data bank free. Here's how to subscribe. Call 1-800-352-1555 today to receive 28 issues of Business Week for only $30.50. That's 1-800-352-1555.
Annie returns to the Brazilian beat of percussionist Evelyn Glennie.
Carnival, when it comes, is 60 hours of continuous pandemonium, sanctioned chaos, where the streets are filled with tourists and revelers and the rest of Rio leaves town. It's basically the Catholic Mardi Gras, Shrove Tuesday's final fling before the abstinence of Lent. Here it has a political function too. In theory, the people can forget their troubles and have a few days of wild behavior, which will make them more content with their lot during the rest of the year. Not quite spontaneous street parades feature horse samba bands and groups in costumes threading through the onlookers, but it's only warming up for the main event. The parade will last for the three nights of carnival, each samba school dancing down a straight route in a purpose-built stadium in the center of Rio. For the participants, it's the culmination of 12 months of waiting. As they prepare for the moment, they will become absorbed in the huge noise and color of their procession. These people have gone hungry in order to pay for their costumes, and this is the only time they'll ever wear them. Each group of dancers in this one school is assigned their own extravagant uniform in a vast overall design. Many are in the Kabusu colors of white and blue, including the bateria.
The tambourine players, they've got their own dance routine as well as their routine for the actual song. And so I'll fit in with the rest, but I want to make sure that people see me as a female and not another male, because I'm the only female in the group. My only concern is whether my headdress will stay on. I hope so. It's so big.
Thank you. amid this cacophony, all Glennie's ears are hearing is something like this. When it was all over, what lasting effects did it have on her playing?
I found that when I returned from Rio, I had one or two new pieces, new to me, to perform. And they were quite major pieces as far as percussion, the percussion repertoire is concerned. And but for some reason, even although I hadn't played the pieces for about 2 weeks, I came back and I just immediately went into them and saw them in a completely different light. I felt so open, the sound was so open. It didn't matter if I played the odd wrong note at all. It didn't matter at all. It was just getting the feel there, and the space more than anything, as opposed to being frightened, oh, well, is this right? Or, oh, I played a wrong note there, oh no, and so on. And that spilled over to all my pieces, it really has. And I think I've just really opened my heart up and just said, this is the way I want to play it, you know, this is my way. Let me hear your way, you know, as opposed to perhaps always saying, oh, well, is this right? Or should I be doing it like this or whatever, you know? Try various interpretations and so on. Just let your mind flow as these people did. Familiar. I sometimes see the pieces I'm playing scored for other instruments, for big groups of instruments. So for example, in one particular piece by Ney Rosauro, there are certain rhythms there that are very Brazilian, that are immediate. You think, ah, that's from Brazil or Latin America. And there are certain parts that you can just imagine 20 or 30 musicians playing this, like in the carnival. And so you give it that kind of energy, as opposed to just tinkering away with the rhythm and so on one cowbell. You can really feel that. Something that I want to continue to explore. Certainly the repertoire and to get Brazilian composers interested in writing for percussion in the way that I want to present it is something that I really, you know, want to do in the future, and so that I can include it and present it to Western ears. Thank you.
As you've seen, Evelyn Glennie's deafness causes her virtually no trouble as a musician. Her playing is top-notch and requires no excuses. As a matter of fact, the liner notes for her debut solo album don't even mention that she's deaf, because when it comes to her artistry, it simply has no bearing on the extraordinary quality of her work. Next week, an A&E premiere as we again go south of the border, this time all the way to Cuba with the late, great jazz trumpeter Dizzy Gillespie. I'm Elliot Forrest. See you next week.
What can prehistoric cave paintings tell us about our past?
Well, let's take a look tomorrow on Ancient Mysteries.
Right now, join us for In Search Of, next on A&E.
A&E's Stage has been brought to you in part by Jeep. There's only one Jeep.
The average day is pretty regimented. That's why there's the Eagle Vision TSI. So every now and then, you can get out of line.
When you think it's perfect...
Put your arms around me.
I love you. Think again. Ed Harris.
I just want to know the truth.
Madeline Stowe.
You said you'd protect me. Do it now.
China Moon, rated R. Starts Friday, March 4th. Like spending time.
This is Dan Regan, inviting you to join us again Monday for As the World Turns. This is CBS.
33 on the hour, sponsored by John Curry Furniture Company, inviting you to visit our new designer gallery downtown Tuscaloosa.
33 Eyewitness News. On the